I think cosmetic science really is very well suited for computational chemistry because it is a very fast moving market and it's driven by science. And just one simple example, there are hundreds of examples that I could talk about, is a lipstick product. There are over 30 steps, all scientific, that are involved in the development of a lipstick. Everything from the formulation down to the testing and then the consumer feedback. And when you think about that, that's a lot of information, that's a lot of testing that needs to be done, and a lot of molecular or mechanistic understanding that may or may not be available to you. There's really a lot of opportunities to innovate and innovate quickly, and that's really where computational chemistry can play an active part in guiding this process. To address that and to bridge the gap between what molecular simulation can do and the final product or raw material or ingredients that you're trying to develop or study, we look at this as a divide and conquer way, or we're what we call, and we're probably not unique in saying this, is holistic modeling. So the idea that you can characterize individual ingredients on their own, you can also look at full product formulations or near full product formulations, depending on the time and length scale. And you can also look at the product performance or package. I'm going to use shampoo as the example here because I think there's a really good story, and we have some data, and some of our industrial collaborators and customers have really driven to use these tools to study all three of these processes because they're all very important in the formulation development, product development, shelf life, and then overall performance. And I think it's really useful to look at how you can apply modeling through the entire process here. Using our method of building standard Martini models and then refining them and tuning the long-range electrostatics, we can look at something like phase behavior. So on the left is an example, not specific to SLES, but the idea that when you just have water and surfactant, or you have water, surfactant, oil, or water, surfactant, and salts, because salts are really important for viscosity building in shampoos. I'll get to that in a minute. As I mentioned, right, salt's really important. It's a viscosity builder. It's in most shampoos. So understanding how that concentration might change the morphology. So whereas you might have spherical micelles at 10% with no salt, you get worm-like chains and a higher viscosity when you have salt present at something like 8 to 10% weight. And then as you go higher, you get worm-like branch, and then you do get that lamellar behavior, though the separation distance does change. We do see that the models that we built from a morphological perspective agree with what's been measured experimentally, independently by multiple groups. Of course, as you add more ingredients and ingredients more complex, you do have to think about, you know, do we have to design new parameters or do we have to do that? But being able to do it in an automated way, something that we advocate for, and we're not alone in that, but we really try and help our customers do this, is a really good way to lowering the barrier to getting this first step done and done right, so that you have confidence that you can apply your models to the next two steps, which is really where we start talking about modeling products in action. So what we're targeting here to replace are the cationic polyelectrolytes. So being able to go from something that's poorly eco-sustainable to something that is sustainable, that has a natural source and can get towards an actual real green solution here, means that we have to think about what can we replace it with, how do we maintain the sensory properties, and then how do we understand the film formation and the biotribology aspects of it. The idea is that the surfactants coat the polymer, at least in the formulation sense, before you put it in the surface of hair and it's able to attach to the surface. And this is what the morphology looks like when you have SLES and Cap B compared to one of the polysaccharide polymers. This is actually the shearing. So now we're looking at all of the surfactants, there's still water in here, and our hair surface. And we're looking at how, what's the drag force? So what's the shearing, the friction, getting to the frictional coefficient. And as you shear, when does that polymer detach? Meaning some of it gets deposited when you rub your two hairs together. And then if you were to dilute this out, what would that look like? And where would things get conditioned? So the hair is not sticking together. It is in fact being deposited, and looking at what that is compared to maybe different types of hair. How do we now leverage machine learning methods on top of the physics based, being able to customize the features, right? So you can use out-of-the-box models and they'll work. We feel rather than generating a bunch of data and using that data as our quote-unquote secret sauce, we think that you can generate unique descriptors for the chemistry classes that you're using like the biosurfactants, which is the number of tails, number of head groups, and using that to help look at the cluster formation or some other property. In summary, we can use machine learning that's chemically aware to help us drive not only formulation development, but also how many simulations to get a reliable model we would need. So I'm going to use two short examples. They're both public. You can go to our extrapolations webpage to look at them in more detail. This platform that we developed with L'Oreal is allowing them to make confident decisions faster. So rather than doing that dartboard approach to formulation development or testing, they're able to use the simulations to drive decision making at the end of the day, a process that would often take them years to generate usable data. A big CPG company like Reckitt, who has adopted this not only for their product development, but also for their sustainable packaging. So for them, using our molecular simulation-based tools allowed them to, you know, expedite timelines to make decisions, you know, 10x faster than a purely experimental approach.